This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Myths and Legends of China by E. T. C. Werner. Chapter 1. The Sociology of the Chinese. Racial Origin. In spite of much research and conjecture, the origin of the Chinese people remains undetermined. We do not know who they were nor whence they came. Such evidence as there is points to their immigration from elsewhere. The Chinese themselves have a tradition of a Western origin. The first picture we have of their actual history shows us not a people behaving as if long settled in a land which was their home and that of their forefathers, but an alien race fighting with wild beasts, clearing dense forests, and driving back the aboriginal inhabitants. Setting aside several theories, including the one that the Chinese are autochthonous and their civilization indigenous, now regarded by the best authorities as untenable, the researches of sinologists seem to indicate an origin, one in early Acadia, or two in Khotan, the Tarim Valley, generally what is now known as eastern Turkestan, or the Kayon Lun Mountains, concerning which more presently. The second hypothesis may relate only to a sojourn of longer or shorter duration on the way from Acadia to the ultimate settlement in China, especially since the Khotan civilization has been shown to have been imported from the Punjab in the 3rd century BC. The fact that serious mistakes have been made regarding the identifications of early Chinese rulers with Babylonian kings, and of the Chinese Po Sing, Cantonese Bak Sing, people with the Bak Sing or Bak tribes, does not exclude the possibility of an Akkadian origin. But in either case, the immigration into China was probably gradual and may have taken the route from Western or Central Asia direct to the banks of the Yellow River, or may possibly have followed that to the southeast through Burma and then to the northeast through what is now China, the settlement of the latter country having thus spread from southwest to northeast, or in a northeasterly direction along the Yangtze River, and so north instead of, as is generally supposed, from north to south. Southern origin improbable. But this latter route would present many difficulties. It would seem to have been put forward merely as ancillary to the theory that the Chinese originated in the Indo-Chinese Peninsula. This theory is based upon the assumptions that the ancient Chinese ideograms include representations of tropical animals and plants, that the oldest and purest forms of the language are found in the south, and that the Chinese and the Indo-Chinese groups of languages are both tonal. But all of these facts, or alleged facts, are as easily or better accounted for by the supposition that the Chinese arrived from the north or northwest in successive waves of migration, the later arrivals pushing the earlier farther and farther toward the south, so that the oldest and purest forms of Chinese would be found just where they are, the tonal languages of the Indo-Chinese Peninsula being in that case regarded as the languages of the vanguard of the migration. Also, the ideograms referred to represent animals and plants of the temperate zone rather than of the tropics. But even if it could be shown, which it cannot, that these animals and plants now belong exclusively to the tropics, that would be no proof of the tropical origin of the Chinese, for in the earliest times the climate of North China was much milder than it is now, and animals such as tigers and elephants existed in the dense jungles which are later found only in more southern latitudes. Expansion of races from north to south. The theory of a southern origin, to which a further serious objection will be stated presently, implies a gradual infiltration of Chinese immigrants through South or mid-China, as above indicated, toward the north, but there is little doubt that the movement of the races has been from north to south, and not vice versa. In what are now the provinces of western Gansu and Sichuan, there lived a people related to the Chinese, as proved by the study of Indo-Chinese comparative philology, who moved into the present territory of Tibet and are known as Tibetans, in what is now the province of Yunnan were the Shan or I Lao, modern Laos, who forced by Mongol invasions emigrated to the peninsula in the south and became the Siamese, and in Indochina, not related to the Chinese, were the enemies, Khmer, Mon, Khasi, Kolarains, whose remnants are dispersed over the hill tracts of central India, and other tribes, extending in prehistoric times into southern China, but subsequently driven back by the expansion of the Chinese in that direction. Arrival of the Chinese in China. Taking into consideration all the existing evidence, the objections to all other theories of the origin of the Chinese seem to be greater than any yet raised to the theory that immigrants from the Tarim Valley or beyond, i.e. from Elam or Akkadia, either direct or via eastern Turkestan, struck the banks of the Yellow River in their eastward journey and followed its course until they reached the localities where we first find them settled, namely in the region covered by parts of the three modern provinces of Shaanxi, Shenxi, and Honan, where their frontiers join. They were then, about 2500 or 3000 BC, in a relatively advanced state of civilization. The country east and south of this district was inhabited by aboriginal tribes with whom the Chinese fought, as they did with the wild animals and the dense vegetation, but with whom they also commingled and intermarried, and among whom they planted colonies as centers from which to spread their civilization. The Kaanlun Mountains. With reference to the Kaanlun Mountains, designated in Chinese mythology as the abode of the gods, the ancestors of the Chinese race, it should be noted that these are identified not with the range dividing Tibet from Chinese Turkestan, but with the Hindu Kush. That brings us somewhat nearer to Babylon, and the apparent convergence of the two theories, the Central Asian and the Western Asian, would seem to point to a possible solution of the problem. Nu Kua, one of the alleged creators of human beings, and Nu and Kua, the first two human beings, according to a variation of the legend, are placed in the Kaanlun Mountains. That looks hopeful. Unfortunately, the Kaanlun legend is proved to be of Taoist origin. Kaanlun is the central mountain of the world, and 3,000 miles in height. There is the fountain of immortality, and thence flow the four great rivers of the world. In other words, it is the Sumeru of Hindu mythology transplanted into Chinese legend, and for our present purpose without historical value. It would take up too much space to go into details of this interesting problem of the origin of the Chinese and their civilization, the cultural connections or similarities of China and Western Asia in pre-Babylonian times, the origin of the two distinct culture areas so marked throughout the greater part of Chinese history, etc., and it will be sufficient for our present purpose to state the conclusion to which the evidence points. Provisional conclusion. Pending the discovery of decisive evidence, the following provisional conclusion has much to recommend it, namely, that the ancestors of the Chinese people came from the West, from Akkadia or Elam, or from Khotan, or, more probably, from Akkadia or Elam via Khotan, as one nomad or pastoral tribe or group of nomad or pastoral tribes, or as successive waves of immigrants reached what is now China proper at its northwest corner, settled round the elbow of the Yellow River, spread northeastward, eastward, and southward, conquering, absorbing, or pushing before them the aborigines into what is now south and southwest China. These aboriginal races, who represent a wave or waves of Neolithic immigrants from Western Asia earlier than the relatively high-headed immigrants into North China, who arrived about the 25th or 24th century BC, and who have left so deep an impress on the Japanese, mixed and intermarried with the Chinese in the south, eventually producing the pronounced differences in physical, mental, and emotional traits, in sentiments, ideas, languages, processes, and products from the Northern Chinese which are so conspicuous at the present day. Inorganic environment. At the beginning of their known history, the country occupied by the Chinese was the comparatively small region above mentioned. It was then a tract of an irregular oblong shape, lying between latitude 34 degrees and 40 degrees north, and longitude 107 degrees and 114 degrees east, This territory round the elbow of the Yellow River had an area of about 50,000 square miles and was gradually extended to the sea coast on the northeast as far as longitude 119 degrees, when its area was about doubled. It had a population of perhaps 1 million, increasing with the expansion to 2 millions. This may be called Infant China. Its period, the feudal period, was in the 2000 years between the 24th and 3rd centuries BC. During the first centuries of the monarchical period, which lasted from 221 BC to AD 1912, it had expanded to the south to such an extent that it included all of the 18 provinces constituting what is known as China proper of modern times, with the exception of a portion of the west of Kansu and the greater portions of Sichuan and Yunnan. At the time of the Manchu conquest at the beginning of the 17th century AD, it embraced all the territory lying between latitude 18 degrees and 40 degrees north and longitude 98 degrees and 122 degrees E, the 18 provinces or China proper, with the addition of the vast outlying territories of Manchuria, Mongolia, Ili, Koko Nor, Tibet, and Korea with suzerainty over Burma and Annam, an area of more than 5 million square miles, including the 2 million square miles covered by the 18 provinces. Generally, this territory is mountainous in the west, sloping gradually down toward the sea on the east. It contains three chief ranges of mountains and large alluvial plains in the north, east, and south. Three great and about 30 large rivers intersect the country, their numerous tributaries reaching every part of it. As regards geological features, the great alluvial plains rest upon granite, new red sandstone, or limestone. In the north is found the peculiar Loess formation, having its origin probably in the accumulated dust of ages blown from the Mongolian plateau. The passage from north to south is generally from the older to the newer rocks. From east to west, a similar series is found, with some volcanic features in the west and south. Coal and iron are the chief minerals, gold, silver, copper, lead, tin, jade, etc., being also mined. The climate of this vast area is not uniform. In the north, the winter is long and rigorous, the summer hot and dry, with a short rainy season in July and August. In the south, the summer is long, hot, and moist, the winter short. The mean temperature is 50.3 degrees Fahrenheit and 70 degrees Fahrenheit in the north and south, respectively. Generally, the thermometer is low for the latitude, though perhaps it is more correct to say that the Gulf Stream raises the temperature of the west coast of Europe above the average. The mean rainfall in the north is 16, in the south 70 inches, with variations in other parts. Typhoons blow in the south between July and October. Organic environment. The vegetal productions are abundant and most varied. The rice zone, significant in relation to the cultural distinctions above noted, embraces the southern half of the country. Tea, first cultivated for its infusion in AD 350, is grown in the southern and central provinces between the 23rd and 35th degrees of latitude, though it is also found as far north as Shantung, the chief tea district, however, being the large area south of the Yangtze River, east of the Tunjing Lake and Great Siang River, and north of the Kwantung Province. The other chief vegetal products are wheat, barley, maize, millet, the bean, yam, sweet and common potato, tomato, eggplant, ginseng, cabbage, bamboo, indigo, pepper, tobacco, camphor, tallow, groundnut, poppy, watermelon, sugar, cotton, hemp, and silk. Among the fruits grown are the date, mulberry, orange, lemon, pomelo, persimmon, lychee, pomegranate, pineapple, fig, coconut, mango, and banana, besides the usual kinds common in Western countries. The wild animals include the tiger, panther, leopard, bear, sable, otter, monkey, wolf, fox, 27 or more species of ruminants, and numerous species of rodents. The rhinoceros, elephant, and tapir still exist in Yunnan. The domestic animals include the camel and the water buffalo. There are about 700 species of birds and innumerable species of fishes and insects. sociological environment. On their arrival in what is now known as China, the Chinese, as already noted, fought with the Aboriginal tribes. The latter were exterminated, absorbed, or driven south with the spread of Chinese rule. The Chinese picked out the eyes of the land, and consequently the non-Chinese tribes now live in the unhealthy forests or marshes of the south, or in mountain regions difficult of access, some even in trees, a voluntary, not compulsory promotion, though several, such as the Dog Yong in Fujian, retain settlements like islands among the ruling race. In the 3rd century BC began the hostile relations of the Chinese with the northern nomads, which continued throughout the greater part of their history. During the first 6 centuries AD, there was intercourse with Rome, Parthia, Turkey, Mesopotamia, Ceylon, India, and Indochina, and in the 7th century with the Arabs. Europe was brought within the sociological environment by Christian travelers. From the 10th to the 13th century, the north was occupied by Khitans and Nutchans, and the whole empire was under Mongol sway for 88 years in the 13th and 14th centuries. Relations of a commercial and religious nature were held with neighbors during the following 400 years. Regular diplomatic intercourse with Western nations was established as a result of a series of wars in the 18th and 19th centuries. Until recently, the nation held aloof from alliances and was generally averse to foreign intercourse. From 1537 onward, as a sequel of war or treaty, concessions, settlements, etc., were obtained by foreign powers. China has now lost some of her border countries and large adjacent islands, the military and commercial pressure of Western nations and Japan having taken the place of the military pressure of the Tartars already referred to. The great problem for her, an agricultural nation, is how to find means and the military spirit to maintain her integrity, the further violation of which could not but be regarded by the student of sociological history as a great tragedy and a worldwide calamity. Physical, emotional, and intellectual characters. The physical characters of the Chinese are too well known to need detailed recital. The original immigrants into North China all belong to blonde races, but the modern Chinese have little left of the immigrant stock. The oblique almond-shaped eyes, with black iris and the orbits far apart, have a vertical fold of skin over the inner canthus, concealing a part of the iris, a peculiarity distinguishing the eastern races of Asia from all other families of man. The stature and weight of brain are generally below the average. The hair is black, coarse, and cylindrical, the beard scanty or absent. The color of the skin is darker in the south than in the north. Emotionally, the Chinese are sober, industrious, of remarkable endurance, grateful, courteous, and ceremonious, with a high sense of mercantile honor, but timorous, cruel, unsympathetic, mendacious, and libidinous. Intellectually, they were until recently, and to a large extent still are, non-progressive, in bondage to uniformity and mechanism in culture, imitative, unimaginative, torpid, indirect, suspicious, and superstitious. The character is being modified by intercourse with other peoples of the earth, and by the strong force of physical, intellectual, and moral education. Marriage in early times. Certain parts of the marriage ceremonial of China, as now existing, indicate that the original form of marriage was by capture, of which, indeed, there is evidence in the classical Book of Odes. But a regular form of marriage, in reality a contract of sale, is shown to have existed in the earliest historical times. The form was not monogamous, though it seems soon to have assumed that of a qualified monogamy consisting of one wife and one or more concubines, the number of the latter being as a rule limited only by the means of the husband. The higher the rank, the larger was the number of concubines and handmaids, in addition to the wife proper, the palaces of the kings and princes containing several hundreds of them. This form it has retained to the present day, though associations now exist for the abolition of concubinage. In early times, as well as throughout the whole of Chinese history, concubinage was in fact universal, and there is some evidence also of polyandry, which, however, cannot have prevailed to any great extent. The age for marriage was 20 for the man and 15 for the girl, celibacy after 30 and 20 respectively being officially discouraged. In the province of Shantung, it was usual for the wives to be older than their husbands. The parents' consent to the betrothal was sought through the intervention of a matchmaker. The proposal originating with the parents, and the wishes of the future bride and bridegroom not being taken into consideration. The conclusion of the marriage was the progress of the bride from the house of her parents to that of the bridegroom, where after various ceremonies she and he worshipped his ancestors together, the worship amounting to little more than an announcement of the union to the ancestral spirits. After a short sojourn with her husband, the bride revisited her parents, and the marriage was not considered as finally consummated until after this visit had taken place. The status of women was low, and the power of the husband great, so great that he could kill his wife with impunity. Divorce was common, and all in favor of the husband, who, while he could not be divorced by her, could put his wife away for disobedience or even for loquaciousness. A widower remarried immediately, but refusal to remarry by a widow was esteemed an act of chastity. She often mutilated herself or even committed suicide to prevent remarriage, and was posthumously honored for doing so. Being her husband's as much in the other world as in this, remarriage would partake of the character of unchastity and insubordination. The argument, of course, not applying to the case of the husband, who by remarriage simply adds another member to his clan without infringing on anyone's rights. Marriage in monarchical and republican periods. The marital system of the early classical times, of which the above were the essentials, changed but little during the long period of monarchical rule, lasting from 221 BC to AD 1912. The principal object, as before, was to secure an heir to sacrifice to the spirits of deceased progenitors. Marriage was not compulsory, but old bachelors and old maids were very scarce. The concubines were subject to the wife, who was considered to be the mother of their children as well as her own. Her status, however, was not greatly superior. Implicit obedience was exacted from her. She could not possess property, but could not be hired out for prostitution. The latter vice was common, in spite of the early age at which marriage took place, and in spite of the system of concubinage, which is after all but a legalized transfer of prostitutional cohabitation to the domestic circle. Since the establishment of the Republic in 1912, the landslide in the direction of Western progress has had its effect also on the domestic institutions. But while the essentials of the marriage contract remain practically the same as before, the most conspicuous changes have been in the accompanying ceremonial, now sometimes quite foreign, but in a very large, perhaps the greatest number of cases, that odious thing, half foreign, half Chinese, as for instance when the procession, otherwise native, includes foreign glass-paneled carriages, or the bridegroom wears a bowler or top hat with his Chinese dress, and in the greater freedom allowed to women who are seen out of doors much more than formerly, sit at table with their husbands, attend public functions and dinners, dress largely in foreign fashion, and play tennis and other games, instead of being prisoners of the inner apartment and household drudges little better than slaves. One unexpected result of this increased freedom is certainly remarkable, and is one not likely to have been predicted by the most far-sighted sociologist. Many of the progressive Chinese, now that it is the fashion for Chinese wives to be seen in public with their husbands, finding the uneducated, gauche, small-footed household drudge unable to compete with the smarter foreign-educated wives of their neighbors, have actually repudiated them and taken unto themselves spouses whom they can exhibit in public without loss of face. It is, however, only fair to add that the total number of these cases, though by no means inconsiderable, appears to be proportionately small. Parents and children. As was the power of the husband over the wife, so was that of the father over his children. Infanticide, due chiefly to poverty and varying with it, was frequent, especially in the case of female children, who were but slightly esteemed, the practice prevailing extensively in 3 or 4 provinces, less extensively in others, and being practically absent in a large number. Beyond the fact that some penalties were enacted against it by the Emperor Qianlong, AD 1736-96, and that by statute it was a capital offense to murder children in order to use parts of their bodies for medicine, it was not legally prohibited. When the abuse became too scandalous, in any district proclamations condemning, it would be issued by the local officials. A man might, by purchase and contract, adopt a person as son, daughter, or grandchild, such person acquiring thereby all the rights of a son or daughter. Descent, both of real and personal property, was to all the sons of wives and concubines as joint heirs, irrespective of seniority. Bastards received half shares. Estates were not divisible by the children during the lifetime of their parents or grandparents. The head of the family being but the life renter of the family property, bound by fixed rules, wills were superfluous, and were used only where the customary respect for the parents gave them a voice in arranging the details of the succession. For this purpose, verbal or written instructions were commonly given. In the absence of the father, the male relatives of the same surname assumed the guardianship of the young. The guardian exercised full authority and enjoyed the surplus revenues of his ward's estate, but might not alienate the property. There are many instances in Chinese history of extreme devotion of children to parents, taking the form of self, wounding, and even of suicide, in the hope of curing parents' illnesses or saving their lives. Political history. The country inhabited by the Chinese on their arrival from the West was, as we saw, the district where the modern provinces of Shanxi, and Honan join. This they extended in an easterly direction to the shores of the Gulf of Chile, a stretch of territory about 600 miles long by 300 broad. The population, as already stated, was between 1 and 2 millions. During the first 2,000 years of their known history, the boundaries of this region were not greatly enlarged, but beyond the more or less undefined borderland to the south were Chou or colonies, nuclei of Chinese population, which continually increased in size through conquest of the neighboring territory. In 221 BC, all the feudal states into which this territory had been parceled out and which fought with one another were subjugated and absorbed by the state of Qin, which in that year instituted the monarchical form of government, the form which obtained in China for the next 21 centuries. Though the origin of the name China has not yet been finally decided, the best authorities regard it as derived from the name of this feudal state of Qin. Under this short-lived dynasty of Qin and the famous Han dynasty, 221 BC to AD 221, which followed it, the empire expanded until it embraced almost all the territory now known as China proper, the 18 provinces of Manchu times. To these were added in order between 194 BC and AD 1414, Korea, Xinjiang, the new territory or eastern Turkestan, Manchuria, Formosa, Tibet, and Mongolia, Formosa and Korea being annexed by Japan in 1895 and 1910 respectively. Numerous other extra-China countries and islands, acquired and lost during the long course of Chinese history, at one time, from 73 to 48 BC, all Asia from Japan to the Caspian Sea was tributary to the Middle Kingdom, i.e., China, it is not necessary to mention here. During the Southern Song Dynasty, 1127 to 1280, the Tartars owned the northern half of China, as far down as the Yangtze River, and in the Yuan Dynasty, 1280 to 1368, they conquered the whole country. During the period 1644 to 1912, it was in the possession of the Manchus. At present, the five chief component peoples of China are represented in the striped national flag from the top downward by red Manchus, yellow Chinese, blue Mongolians, white Mohammedans, and black Tibetans. This flag was adopted on the establishment of the Republic in 1912 and supplanted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.